Jamie to take lunch.
If the only person I'll have to gavel is Mr. Badley here.
You want me to gavel?
No, I'm teasing because you're the only one talking, you're the one so quiet out there. So we will call to order 6:11. And before we are reconvened, let's do the Pledge of Allegiance. How about you, Cliff?
Sure.
I don't think you've done it before, have you?
Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I think that cadence right when there's no students in the audience. It's a little different. There's kids here, it's a little real snowy. Okay, that brings us to item 5, adoption and approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
I don't think we have any issues. Okay, no, no changes, okay, great. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Item 6, approval of the minutes, and we have 3 sets of minutes on here. 6.1, approval of the minutes of May 21st, 2017.
So moved.
I wasn't there for
me either.
Second.
Okay, and I just, so just the 3 of us were there, we were not, and I just wanted to draw attention the 2 board members that weren't here, I'm sure you've read it, but there appears to be some misunderstanding or miscommunication about the emergency resolution. So I wanted to make sure, I wanted to draw your attention to the fact that the resolution that was passed was amended to remove discipline and naming of employees that were not on strike. I know that we got some correspondence about that, and I wanted to make sure that you knew which resolution was passed. So you have any questions on?
Yeah, no, I did notice that, and then I did see it in flyers, though, that the board had specifically
it was caught, and I think a few of you were here that day.
No, that was an error because it was amended, and Sherry also at the meeting, in the open meeting, clearly went over the amendments and stated what the board's position was on that.
And where can I read that?
It should be attached now.
Okay.
The resolution. So.
And I guess, can you just clarify what was stated?
Yeah, that? I can read it to you right now. It's on the minutes that were in there, it's spelled out. So it was changed from disciplinary report to board report. We've removed setting forth the name and relevant information concerning each employee who is believed to have been setting forth the relevant information concerning employees' conduct believed to have been engaged in a walkout, slowdown, work stoppage, or the strike-related activity. And then I made a note to explain that it was an acts of boilerplate resolution, mm-hmm. and that we didn't want that in there, and that the board had absolutely no desire to know the names of anyone that went on strike, nor were any employees to be punished for striking.
Okay.
And remember, we specifically struck the word disciplinary.
Changed it from disciplinary report to board report. So the other items that were in there was if there was property damage, if there was criminal conduct, that those things the superintendent would inform us of. None of those things did occur. So,
okay.
Good. Okay. So just the 3 of us, all in favor?
Yeah.
Oh, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, 6.2, approval of the minutes of May 22nd, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
I don't think you were at that one either, were you, Phoebe?
So Phoebe was there.
I wasn't.
Or
there.
Ellen was there.
But Ellen wasn't there. She was. You think you were gone for all of this, right? You were in DC.
Yes, I was in DC.
Okay, so Ellen's out for all of them.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm sorry, did you make the second?
Mm-hmm. Frank did.
Oh, Phoebe. Yes.
Okay. Any questions, changes? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 6.3, approval of the minutes of the May 23rd, 2017 meeting.
So moved. Well,
second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Those were boom, boom, boom. I didn't even realize they were.
Yeah, 21, 22.
22,
23. Other than
that, we had a big deal. Oh, we had a deal. Okay. Item 7, special recognitions, reports, and presentation. 7.1, Cliff. Assistant Superintendent, Educational Services, presentation report of the 2017-2020 Local Control Accountability Plan. Take it away.
All right.
I think these were too strong.
Did you get there? You're
getting ahead of it.
Get a little bit.
Okay, can you turn the TV on?
Are you going up on
I
the
thought
screen?
It was going to be on the screen. I thought, wow,
on
this
the
is
screen.
For the LCAP, of, just an oral report will be a... couldn't possibly be that quick.
No. Move to approve.
Yeah.
So, this isn't an action item. Educational item, eventually.
All right, so I've got a couple things for you. I've got a slideshow that I'll review with you, and then you all should have hard copies of this executive summary. We will be sharing with you the, as of now, 101-page cap, but I thought I'd use this executive summary tool to focus your attention. So it may help in some regards. It may have cause or create more questions, which I'll be able to flip over. I have the LCAP up on the screen. We'll be able to flip over and show you a few examples for areas where you may have questions. So if you recall, in our LCAP process, we are towards the end now. We are still finalizing a few of the narratives and a few of the projected budget figures, which later on tonight you'll see the budget presentation. We'll be able to add those soon, and then at the next board meeting, we'll have our public hearing on the LCAP, and one after that, we'll get for board approval. I wanted to go over the first few sections in the LCAP, the new format, which are highlights, greatest progress, greatest needs, and performance gaps. So I wanted to kind of highlight those before we go to the executive summary. So if you don't mind holding off on the executive summary for a minute. So the highlights in our LCAP are high school graduates. We've been graduating students at a high rate. So we're in the high category in the new system, in the dashboard system. So we're rated high. Very high is 95%. We're at 94.7. So we want to strive to get over that and get into very high range. We've made good ELA progress. We have good academic achievement across the board. This past school year, we newly implemented an academic curriculum TK through 5, which follows along the heels of our 6 through 12 math adoption, which this next school year we will have fully implemented Common Core Math 6 through 12. So this will be the first year of integrated Math 3. So you'll no longer see Alpha 2 coming up this next year. So we're still in the process of fully implementing math. We will be purchasing a new SCADA data management system this next school year, which will help us identify and provide intervention sooner. We're going to slowly roll it out with admin and principals and lead teachers that we'll train next year, to then the following year roll it out more to teachers in the classroom. They can create assessments, form assessments to use in the classroom. We're not going to roll all of that out right now. We don't want to overkill and drown anyone.
Is that ARIES?
So no, we currently have ARIES. ARIES is our student information system. Mm-hmm. This is a student data management system. So this will pull directly from sources like TASP, some of the supplemental things that we do, the intervention tools that we use in the schools, Lexia, other things like that. We'll be able to pull directly from those sources to give teachers student assessment information. How the kids are doing, how they're doing now. Some of it, it'll pull quarterly. Some it does nightly updates with ARIES, to pull information from ARIES. So much more user-friendly, much more graphical, really easy to pull data. If you attended any of our LCAP meetings, you saw how difficult it was to gather information, to gather the right data. So that'll help with that as well. Some of the other highlights, we've been using our supplemental funds both for district-wide actions and school-wide actions targeted on these students, and we've made great strides in engaging students and parents and guardians. The greatest progress we've made, as you'll see in the LCAP, is our high graduation rate. That's one of them, and that's due to some of these things that the LCAP addresses that we believe have supported this. Our low staffing ratios in those areas, access to Common Core, state standards line materials, different pathway options that students have, the variety of intervention supports that we offer. We do fund some additional support personnel for social emotional support, as well as counseling, as well as an alt ed. And with the help of a adult ed, we're able to provide family support and family education. Another one of our greatest progress is our ELA achievement. So if you recall the new format, they take our past data, roll it up into their little way of judging it. So level 3, if you recall, in the CASP is meeting the standard. Level 4 is above, exceeding the standard. 2 is nearly met, 1 is not met. So 3 is the standard that I'm looking for. So our average score in ELA was 14.3 points above a level 3. So our district average is meeting the standard, slightly above that. We received a maintained rating in our change. Even though we increased 2.5 points, that's still in the maintained area. So you can drop a little, you can stay stagnant, you can grow a little. And for each state indicator, that maintained category changes a little. So even though we maintained, we did have some growth in the ELA. We've been working with a group of teachers. There's a committee that's been working on identifying materials to pilot for ELA and ELD, which will happen next year, TK through 8. I also believe our Accelerate Honors Advanced English courses have helped contribute to this, to our success in ELA, and the ongoing staff development, professional development. Our greatest needs, one of them is suspension rate. If you recall when we looked at the dashboard, that was one of the areas that was in, so it was in orange or red, it was calling out to us. And our English learner progress, we need to make better headway there. I put an asterisk on the suspension rate. If you recall, we learned after this information came out, we kind of looked in reflexively to try to figure out why that is, and looked at our data to figure out what was the state pulling, and we didn't think our suspension rate was as bad as they had shared with us. So we found out that one of the things we were doing in Aries was when students were sent to the office, maybe consulted with an administrator, and were held for the rest of the period or asked to sit in the office and not go directly back to the classroom where there was a confrontation or an issue, those were being coded in our system as suspensions. So that's one thing that Dave and his group were able to identify. So we've corrected that now, but this data gets pulled a couple years behind when CBEDS gets verified. So we'll see some growth going forward in that just because we're coding it correctly now. So you'll see some growth there anyways. But so that was a little bit of an anomaly.
May I ask a question about that now? Would you like me to wait to hear that?
You can ask that.
So when you say that it'll be coded correctly now, my understanding is that the site will tell you that if your sixth grade child wasn't getting along with another student and they were pulled into the office, that is an in-house suspension. Is that not an in-house suspension?
Well, how did Dave answer that?
In-house suspension is when a child is removed for instruction for a longer period than just a timeout or for a discussion. It's a decision that they're no longer going to be in class for the rest of the day.
Now, what parameters around that? Two questions, two-part question. My eyes are having trouble focusing. It was too strong. I apologize. So, I should know this. I apologize. For example, at Petaluma Junior High, which could also be similar to McKinley, not Cherry Valley or Pembroke, because Petaluma Junior High is actually housing two campuses on the traditional side of the ledger there, the sixth grade academy and Petaluma Junior Middle School. Like McKinley, we have a traditional campus, we have a MAPS, and we have a PACS charter. So my question, transparency out there, because it applied to my own child, I didn't want to ask, I didn't want it to look like I was trying to get my child off the hook of a punishment or something. I probably should have, but I felt uncomfortable at the time. So I'll ask you here. If a sixth grade child, is there a difference between the punishment a sixth grade child gets in another school, say Grant Elementary, McNair, wherever, and a sixth grade child at sixth grade academy, because they're being punished the same as a seventh or eighth grader at that school because they're considered a middle schooler, which actually, funding-wise and things, they're not actually a middle schooler, they're actually a sixth grader. Do you see where I'm kind of circling around with that?
Yes, but the grade and the school site and the program don't matter. So when administrators looking at a situation like that, the first thing they're looking at is immediate safety. And the second thing they're doing is to stop recidivism. And so they may use a different disposition for two students in the same school based upon the history of the discipline of that student, their background, whatever's taking place. They want to use a disposition, a consequence that's going to stop the behavior from happening. If a student is committing an act and they're repeating the same act over and over again, and the other student involved, this is their first time, they could get two separate consequences.
What if they don't? What if, for example, I think I can talk about it because I'm giving up my own confidentiality because I'm the parent. So you have a sixth grader and eighth grader get in a fist fight. Maybe a sixth grader that's never been in trouble before, who's clearly now got a suspension on his record because he, and the action happened several weeks before anyone found out. Investigating this issue over here, oh yeah, that kid punched this kid out last week too. That kid was my kid. He was punched in the head three times to the ground. Didn't fight back, didn't throw a first punch. But he got a suspension and was pulled out of class for the rest of the day.
Yeah, so, I wouldn't want to answer that without hearing
right.
the administrator's version.
But so is that the kind of thing that is going to continue to be a suspension for
without
account?
Fail, if you use physical violence on another student, you're going to get suspended.
Right.
Whether it's first offense or second offense. If you're using physical violence on another
student.
Right,
in a situation where you weren't using physical violence on another student.
Right.
But you still got the suspension.
And so it's going to be case by case.
Yeah.
Because we don't want it to be a situation where we're going to a piece of paper to determine the outcome for our students.
Right, but it's just interesting. I think we need to be really careful in this situation. I'm not concerned. I don't think my child's going to end up with a bunch of suspensions again. I don't know. But so I didn't, it's fine. I don't care. But when this came up later, when I was sitting in the LCAP, and I thought, oh gosh, I'm pretty sure they classified that as an in-house suspension for the rest of the afternoon. So I know he missed the next 2 hours of school after lunch. So I think we need to, maybe we do for purposes of our LCAP, need to have some kind of checklist or something. It seems like if every administrator could view a situation differently, and so.
We do. We do that. We meet once a month as APs okay. and counselors. We talk about these situations. And the APs and the principals, before they dispense a consequence, they're doing a consult.
Okay.
And we're talking through that.
Okay.
And we're asking all of those questions that you just asked each time.
Because now it becomes more important than just
well, the data
sitting
point,
a kid in the office.
The data point is way down
that
there.
Way.
The data point is way down there in terms of our priorities. It's the safety and to stop recidivism. Mm-hmm. Those are our key. And if the rate is a little bit higher because we have, then we need to address the symptom, not the action, and not try to worry about the data.
Right, my point is if you're just having a child come sit and miss class, I don't know if we want to be calling those suspensions.
Right, and that's what Cliff just said, is we have fixed that.
So, I'm not sure if I'm clear on what we're calling that then. Are we just calling that kid he sat in class? Or
it's an activity. It's coded as a V, a school activity,
instead of an S,
as a suspension.
That's what I wasn't understanding.
Or a CS,
what we're doing
or a class suspension.
Now.
But if the disposition is in school suspension specifically,
then
or out of school suspension, it's counted as a suspension.
But we're having clear conversations with just because you had a kid sit out and miss a period or something doesn't mean you automatically classify it as a suspension, unless that's who your real intent is to be like an in.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But
sorry.
So thus the asterisk, right? That we were quantifying and counting things for in suspension.
Well, because I was just thinking about elementary school. You could have kids that are sitting in the office all the time, and if every time a kid was having some kind of problem, he sat in the office and he threw an S up there.
That's what was happening in some cases. So.
Okay.
All right, so those are the greatest needs, and these come from the dashboard. We didn't have any yellow. Or we didn't have any orange or red areas, remember the little Trivial Pursuit pie pieces. We did have some yellows, and that's why we're addressing some of them.
Oh, I have a question about the English learner progress, because you just showed the ELA is up. So what's up with English learner?
So
where's that stand?
Well, you'll see. So in the summary and in our actions, we are moving to address this.
Okay.
So a lot,
So the EL kids are not progressing the way the rest are in ELA. Is that what that means?
Correct, yeah. And you're going to see, well, there's two things. So one is how they perform in ELA. There's also their English learner progress. So are they progressing? Are they becoming English proficient? Are they becoming fluent? So it's two different measures.
Yes.
Related, because it's English, but two different things. So you'll see in the next slide when I bring up performance gaps.
Okay.
This group's going to come up again. But this should provide some context into the summary. So you're going to see some of our actions are specifically directed towards ELA, towards ELD, the TK through 8 pilot that the materials we're piloting next year are newly state adopted in the past few years, and they specifically address English learners. So here's our gaps. So there they are again. So students with disabilities, there's definitely a gap between students with disabilities and the norm in graduation rate in English and in math.
Real quick, so who sets that norm? It's reset every year?
So the state. So this comes from that dashboard again.
Right.
So
is the norm reset every year, or is it standardized?
So they said for 3 to 5 years, they're going to keep those cut scores the same. So that's the same. For ELA and math, they take an average each year. They take your average score and score you how close above or below you are to level 3. That will change year to year because how we do collectively. But the rest, the cut points are set.
So it's okay.
You're set by the state.
Set by the state. And they use real data.
Before they were more volatile, but now you say there's going to be a better benchmark.
Sorry, say that again.
There'll be a better benchmark. It'll be more stable.
Yeah,
at least 3 to 5 years.
At least 3 to 5 years.
Yeah.
Until they come up with a new test.
Yeah. So, and then an asterisk I didn't put, but when we talk about graduation rate for students with disabilities, this is the 4-year cohort graduation. So these are, so we know that some special ed students may stay in school longer, they may take an extra semester or two to finish out. Those count against the graduation rate. Those are non-completers. So the goal still is to graduate everyone in 4 years. Low-income students, there's a gap in English language arts and the norm. And the suspension rate of several groups, there's a few, I didn't list them all. But again, we know part of that is our tracking. So we should have better data next year and our English learner progress. So jumping to the summary, so now you have your country. And I have copies if anybody wants them. Want to share these out? So, pros and cons to this format. I'll show you in a second one of the cons. But so for every, we have 4 main goals, and for each of these goals, we have what are called indicators or metrics, where we currently are, what's our baseline, and what our goal is moving forward. So goal one is basically facilities and program, learning environment, 21st century tools. I've summarized very briefly each action or service under those. I separated them out into the total expenditure and then the LCFF supplemental budgeted and projected expenditures in the LCAP for next year. So what you don't see here, if you look at action to service 1.1 qualified staff, K-53 staffing ratio, that totals to about 57 million, but what you don't see is on the LCAP you see this. Action 1.1, all of this is listed, all of the programs, instruction program, library services, pupil support, school admin, facility operations, central services, special ed, career tech. So in this summary, you're just seeing the one figure. In the LCAP, you'll see it's very detailed. And we've separated all the expenditures out in this year's LCAP into elementary and secondary. You can see the total. You can also see it separated out by the fund we're using with the 2 different districts. So just wanted to show you, there's a lot more info behind these numbers. So if you go through, we have each of our goals. So goal one, some of these goals are continuing in the new format. The first goal or 2 or 3 are what are called base.
coming out of unrestricted funds or other supplementary funds that's not LCFF. And then we get into the supplemental monies and supplemental actions. So if you look at goal two, is where
we... So the supplemental money, that's based on those subgroups?
That's based on our unduplicated count.
Okay.
So remember, the LCFF is made up of the base, which is adjusted for grade span adjustment K3 and for tech ed for adjusted base. And then for the unduplicated count of EL, foster, and low income, we get an additional 20% of the base for those students. And that's important to remember because that supplemental is what creates our proportionality, which is at the end we all have. But LCFF is broader in that it's all of our general fund funding that comes from the state, and generally it's made up of lots of different components. But the LCFF is your base, grade span adjustment for tech ed, and then for us, supplemental. For other districts, they get concentration grants too, but we're not there.
And then we have to decide how to spend that supplemental.
Yep. Based on, like our previous slides, our needs, where we improve our
gaps. Based on what the data says.
Sure. So, like 1.7, Director of Ed Services. So we choose to fund that position in supplemental funds.
Yeah. That job is basically entirely looking at student groups, student performance, working with principals, working with teachers, stuff. So you'll see some things on the detail of LCAP. You'll see there are some things in 1.1 that you see later where we, with supplemental funds, are adding support above and beyond the base funding. So you'll see there are certain items where we mention that specifically. There are library services included in 1.1. We also fund additional library services. We staff the ratios in certain areas, and we provide supplemental support above and beyond that in certain items. So you'll see in some of these it says additional things like that. So if you look at, a lot of the non-LCFF supplemental money is spent in goal one, just base program. There is obviously some supplemental there, about over 700,000. Goal two, you'll see this is where we spend a lot of our money, a lot of our attention. So this is student outcomes, graduating college and career ready students. So we have quite a few metrics here, and they're cleaned up. These metrics now come straight from the dashboard. So it's easier to find this information year in, year out. You'll see if you look down the baseline column, some of the data isn't as current as we'd like it to be. So I pointed out, so some of this is 13-14, some of it's 15-16, some of it's last year. I do want to point your attention to the college career preparedness percentage, the CCI. That just was released last week from the state. That was one of the dashboard reports that was coming soon. They just released it, so they take into account students in CTE pathways, students passing AP exams, a variety of factors to create that. And so this is, you'll see this from now on, the percentage of students prepared. So this is kind of like the A through G, but for career.
Don't we have data, not only just showing CCI, but don't we actually have data showing how many of our students each year go into a four-year university or a state school?
We haven't used that as a metric before. We do get some of that information back, but that's always a hard thing to track. For example, CTE, each year as part of Perkins, we have to send out surveys and hope to get information back. So we don't always have, as up-to-date or current or accurate information as we'd like, but the state is moving in that direction to try to get more, track more of that information.
It seems to me when Troy and I talked about tracking that, I don't know you put it under your LCAP, but that given that virtually every senior, by the time he or she graduates, if they're going to go for your school right out of, for your college right out of high school, they know. And that you felt that information was obtainable. through counseling or something. So I think it would
be. So those that attend state colleges, we definitely get that information back.
Let's be any college, you see, because they'll really have to commit by long before June.
But some of the students who go out of state, we don't always, we can't get that information back, unless we get them to the state college, we give reports back from the state.
So just you're saying it's just hard to catch up with the track.
Well, the question is whether you want to do, because you could definitely do word of mouth, but is it accurate data?
Yeah.
Casa Grande does National Clearinghouse, and they gather some data, and that's some of the things that they refer to. We could put that as a local measure, but...
Well, does it add anything?
Well, part of the trade-off is then, you know, do you want your counselor spending time gathering data in that manner, or, you know, we could look at what if there's potential things like National Clearinghouse they could go through and scrub and look for our students.
Yeah, well, it just seems like it's that next piece, like, okay, you're ready,
yes,
but did you ever show up at the game? You know, you're ready for the game.
Well, even more than that, did you stick it out?
Well, that'd be even more, like how...
Are you actually staying, and how many, you know, because the percentage of students that are one and done is really, really high.
Really high, yeah.
Throughout the state.
So the Perkins information, that's the one place where I know that is gathered yearly by the district. And we only know by those who respond. But it's how many are currently still, how many are employed in a career in a CTE area, how many continued with school, how many with the military.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
More specific.
Okay.
Right?
I was just going to say, this is for public relations and the work that Gary's been doing with our realtors. I think it would be really a nice thing, whether we can do it now or a year from now. Number of kids that go on to JC, number of kids that go on to a four-year state or a university, private. That would be stuff that is a realtor is handing out their flyer saying, hey, this is, if your kid goes to Petaluma, this is what it's going to look like. You know. So eventually, if we could get to that point, I would support that.
I think what my trustee Badley is saying is, I think we've been asking for that for a few years.
Right, it's hard.
It's come my nice way.
Dial the new stuff into that, apparently,
yeah.
Or the new.
Right.
We've been talking about that.
For that exact reason.
Really capturing.
Yeah. Right. But it is. It's hard to even come up. Because a lot of it is word of mouth. Mm-hmm. So it was.
Another thing for
David. No, Gary makes a good point.
It's good somewhere.
So, it's kind of bring us back. So the CCI, we were told by the state last week, they will put in our most recent results. So in the fall, we'll get an updated CCI. So we'll have a new baseline. We'll be able to shift this over and have a more current goal for next year for this area.
I have a quick question. I'm just looking at the college readiness for the juniors.
Mm-hmm.
And how does that relate to the level 3 where we are above? Is that?
Great question. So students who score at level 4 met, so exceeded the standard, that's
college ready.
That's
okay.
This top number.
Okay.
The conditionally ready, which I didn't put in here, but the conditionally ready are those that score a 3.
Yeah.
Okay. As June, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it just, that seemed low, I wasn't sure.
Yeah, that's just those that, so that's actually, so
30%
of our students
that
exceeded the standard in English.
4 or above.
Right.
4 or 5. Okay.
No, there's no 5, just 4. That's the
just
top 4?
Score. Okay.
1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah.
Looks
all right.
I have a question about under planned actions and services.
Mm-hmm.
The 2.2 additional AP honors, advanced sections, AP exam fees. What's the $82,000?
So we are funding next year 5 additional sections, mm-hmm. 2 at Casa Grande, 2 at Petaluma High, 1 at Kenilworth. For them, we've talked about access to
yes.
these
mm-hmm.
advanced courses, and sometimes you don't get a nice, neat group of 32.
Right.
So in these cases, these principals have more students than they've had before. They want to be able to support them, so they've kind of had to plead their case with me and show me the data. So we've, through College Readiness Block Grant, we brought that back months and months ago about our plan. So part of our plan was to use some of those funds to add these sections, to give a little more room. Like, you know, at Kenilworth last year, we were tight. No movement, whether you wanted to move in or out. So this also is a result of students who opted in above and beyond those that qualify versus, you know, with our objective measures. So these are students who've opted in. We want to be able to provide them that space.
On that note, how is that going at the junior highs for next year?
Well, we have one additional section at Kenilworth.
So math and or English.
We worked really hard with them, honestly, Linda Shaley and I and Cliff, in trying to make sure that we were all agreeing on where we thought the projected enrollment was going to be and what the staffing was going to be. So, you know, last year I think it was problematic because we had a fairly new principal and we had a lot of transition, certainly in my seat. And so I think that there wasn't necessarily agreement reached. But the other thing is predicting the kids that are going to show up is really, you know, I have a crystal ball in my office, but it's kind of fuzzy at times. So we're going to be evaluating that with them into July and August, because if we need to make tweaks and changes, we will, one way or another. But I think that from what I gathered from our meetings, I think that Bennett had a much greater comfort level. Would you agree?
I think the question was yes, numbers are up. Accelerated numbers are up, advanced numbers are up at least two schools that have shared that with me, as far as Casa Grande.
Currently, I was unable to find, when I received a call from a very upset parent, of how you opt in at Kenilworth to 7th grade accelerated math. Last year, I opted in on Petaluma Junior High's website to get a student in to the accelerated 7th grade math. How do you do that right now if you're a Kenilworth incoming 7th grade parent?
So I believe,
I'd like to get back to them and let them know.
I believe, so one, I sent that out to everyone a while ago, to all users in the email system, the new document, the appeal form.
We have it right here.
I believe we have it on our website. Mm-hmm. Right,
can
David?
Can you tell me where it is on the website? Because I have a parent that sat with the principal
last
week.
Yeah,
I've
got a drive. I'll send it to you.
And I was unable.
Yeah.
She asked me.
In fact,
me,
I was just looking at it today. Go figure.
Because she asked me how to opt in. I couldn't find it, so I said, "I think you need to email
the principal
immediately."
It's contacting the principal. Yeah.
So do students, like when my daughter went to Petaluma High School, she had to take a test so that she could get into honors. So now, is that still the case, or is it now that students can say, "I'm up for the challenge. I want to take this class."
Both. So we do have objective measures to try to identify,
okay,
who, you know, who'd be successful potentially based off of these measures. For math, we use the MDTP, comes out of San Diego State. They have a kind of a placement exam for each grade level of the Common Core math, so it's a pretty good predictor. So we use that as a piece among other objective measures. But that's not the gatekeeper anymore. That's a piece.
Okay.
But yeah, you can't opt in. However, with math specifically, with the new state bill that passed last year, within 1 month of the new school year, we reassess everyone. And if you don't meet that objective standard, we adjust your placement. With every other subject, that's not a requirement. So kind of once you're in, and we expect you to stay in. We're not just, especially, you know, we can't mess with the master schedule and just have 20 kids disappear.
Right.
So math's that one little wrinkle with that Senate bill. So,
and that's a state mandate.
That's,
yes,
state law, yeah.
Got it.
I think, so it meant well, but that little piece is almost an out for some kids, because they're going to reassess them if they didn't meet the mark within that month. And how much growth are you going to have in a month? I don't know. But
yeah, that's it.
So both.
So do you think we're going to have two accelerated math classes at Kenilworth?
Yeah, finding an excellent one. And Petaluma Junior, they didn't need another one. They already had two sections. They could meet their needs. They didn't need the extra support there. So the 82,000 is 1.0 FTE, five sections, plus about, I don't know, where it is, like 13,000 in AP fees for the fee reductions they give for free and reduced.
And remember, these are budgeted amounts, and so those are open sections. So where, and that's why the annual update becomes really important, because what the actual cost will be, we don't know. This is all our best guesses as a budgeted option with open sections.
So you all have access to view the letter that went out to families. So I'm going to give you the name of it if you want to do the search.
I need to share it with you. It's called PCS Open Access Letter to Parents.
Yeah, I feel like we all know.
Yeah.
When was it sent out?
And we got a phone
February 24th was the last edit on it.
Okay, so you got it. Okay,
and
when was it sent out?
And you just go on the website and find it.
It went out
at... No, you got it mailed at home. I'm trying to circle back to somebody that they got this letter on March 1st, and then they went through the math test months, weeks after that.
Well,
I know to those of you that are in education, it seems very simple and there's a timeline, but when you have your very first student going into junior high, particularly if you're on the east side and you're not in our district, it doesn't feel easy.
So I guess maybe I can answer it this way. Part of the letter is a Q&A, and I think the question that you asked is, if a student isn't placed or recommended for placement into an accelerated honors advanced class, what process exists to advocate for my student and ensure placement? And the answer is, please contact your student's assigned counselor to request placement in the course. And then it goes on to detail on that. So that was the directive. They started first with their counselor. However, we know that in about a week, then that becomes the principal will be the only one that's potentially available.
Okay.
They have access to the appeal form, the opt-in form.
Where's the opt-in? Is that online?
No,
or
it was.
So that's what the counselors and principals have access to.
Okay.
So it's not online now. That was something we did last year.
Yeah, last year it was a Google form, like a survey.
Right.
I want to my name.
Okay, and so now it's through the counselor and the principal. Is Kenilworth at risk of losing that second section if they don't have a certain amount of students? And what would that number be?
So
I'm sorry, I had a lengthy, and I meant Gary and I meant to hit on this today, and I didn't get to talk to him. So
although we've slated that 0.2 for this particular purpose. Once we've allocated it, once we staff it, we're not going to necessarily just cut it second week into school if kids drop. If kids drop, they're going to Math 7 from Math 7-8. So we would need another section of Math 7.
My concern is if you're not trying to get kids into that class and you're not very open-minded to a second section of that class and you're not telling parents that they have the opportunity to opt in, parents will not opt in and then you won't have that second section. Do you see what I'm talking about after talking to this parent?
Yeah. So
this
let's follow
lost
up.
Their child in
follow
this
up
class,
with
and this parent was discouraged from opting in.
Yeah.
And this child isn't in our district. I don't want to lose a family because they want their child.
I'll follow up.
Thank you.
Yeah. Let's follow up. Got it.
We talked this morning about.
Got it.
Okay.
The I think it's important to note though.
I hear you say my name over there.
It's important to note that. Students, if you looked at the last 2 years, the students that would not have quote-unquote qualified just by district metrics alone for these courses have thrived, that have been placed in these classes, and in some cases outperformed students that got in based on just a metric.